So indeed, my main background is computer graphics, and more recently I've been interested in 3D modeling. I'm visiting today because 3D modeling may have application in architecture, and I'm looking for new ideas and potentially new collaborations. What I chose to do is to give you an overview of what we've been doing in the group recently. So I won't go deep into the details. I will rather cover several topics, but then don't hesitate to ask me questions if you want particular details on some of the methods I will describe. So indeed, most of the research I will present has been funded by an ERC, which started 3 years ago. And the title is Interpretive Drawings for 3D Design. So the motivation for this research is the observation that drawing is used in many fields of design, from product design, architecture, fashion design, because that's one of the easiest way for a designer to externalize an idea and share it with others. But a drawing alone is not enough to evaluate the feasibility of a concept. And that's why often a drawing is converted into a 3D model on which we can apply simulation engineering tools to actually push the concept all the way towards fabrication. And in practice, there's often many iterations between the creative design phase and the physical validation with 3D engineering. But the main challenge here is that each of those iterations takes significant time because creating a 3D model remains a tedious manual process. And so our goal will be to really accelerate this phase to allow designers to actually perform more iterations in a fastest way. So that comes to the overall ambition of this ERC project. It's to allow computers to understand drawings, really in the goal of providing engineering tools directly to the designer as soon as he starts drawing, or maybe also provide more design alternatives to the engineers. And so here I'm illustrating this goal with this, it's not an actual result, it's what we would like to achieve. So you can imagine a car designer drawing a car and asking the computer to perform a fluid simulation on that car, and that will reveal that the windshield is actually not very aerodynamic, and so the designer can redraw that part. So I call that the ambition of the project, because we are not there yet. There are still many challenges to solve to reach that goal, but really the idea would be to bring a closer interaction loop between design and engineering. But the fundamental problem to solve first is to actually recover 3D information from a line drawing, because that's a necessary step to then apply engineering tools. So this is a nil post problem, because we start from a 2D information and we'd like to recover 3D information. So one first constraint we can enforce is that the shape that we reconstruct should reproject well on the drawing. But that's not enough, because that means that any of those red dots can lie anywhere along the viewing rays. So while we would like to reconstruct this chair, just based on reprojection, a distorted chair is equally valid. So we need additional constraints to lift any ambiguity. And the main approach we've been following so far is to deduce those constraints from how professional designers draw, because they developed techniques to effectively convey 3D information in their drawing. They not only draw the shape, they also draw additional lines that help them construct the drawing and communicate it to others. So for instance, even though the boat is the main topic of the drawing, the designer also included those lines that tell us about the perspective, because they go toward the main vanishing points. Or you can see here lines that designers call cross sections that tell us about the curvature of this shape. And so there are different ways of exploiting those techniques that I will describe in this talk. A first way is really to deduce geometric constraints from those drawing techniques. So for instance, those lines go toward vanishing points, so we can deduce that they are orthogonal in 3D. So based on their 2D angle, we can impose that, we can deduce what 3D shape they should follow to be orthogonal in 3D. So I will describe some of the methods in that spirit. And I think that's the type of work that is closest to what you do, based on what I've seen this morning. But another approach is to adopt more of a data-driven method, where we could also train a computer to recognize the type of shape that designers draw, either at the scale of a complete object, like recognizing that this is a boat, or maybe more locally, recognize that this part is mostly cylindrical, for instance. And that could be done based on prior observation of similar drawings. So we actually explored those two directions, and I will show examples today of methods in those two subfields. But in the long term, I think the two are very complementary. The data-driven approach can give us a very good initial guess that can then be refined by local optimization based on geometric constraints. So I will start with a project that is a bit old, but I think illustrates well our methodology on exploiting geometric constraints from drawings. So it's a project called CrossShade. It was published in 2012. It was a collaboration with people from Toronto and Vancouver. And I will use this project to illustrate a methodology that we've applied actually in several similar problems, where we try to study how people draw, but also how people interpret drawings, perceive drawings, because the two are tightly related. Typically, people draw to communicate information to others, and so they learn drawing techniques that match well the way our brain perceives drawings. And so based on those two sources of information, the drawing literature and the perception literature, we can then deduce geometric constraints that are then suitable for optimization. So let's take a particular example, a type of line that we've exploited in this work, which are called the cross sections. So you see them here, or here. Those are lines that designers draw to convey curvature, and it's actually explicitly said in design books. There's this reference here, cross sections on a surface explain its curvature. So the designers use the keyword curvature. So we found that interesting. We wanted to reinforce this observation, so we looked also in the perceptual literature, and there are studies showing that when we observe two intersecting curves, we tend to interpret them as principal directions of curvature. So let's do a little test. I will ask you, what surface do you perceive in this drawing? Yeah, a piece of a pipe, a cylinder. Indeed, that's what most people perceive. So you interpret this direction as the direction of minimal curvature and this one as maximal curvature. Let's do another test for this one. Yeah, a flattened sphere. That's also what most people perceive. Those could have been drawn on a cylinder as well, but that's not what you would perceive first, because in the absence of context, you will interpret them as principal directions of curvature on a, some kind of ellipsoid. So here it was just a little trick I played, but I took those images from those papers, just to confirm this idea that designers will not try to trick you. They prefer to make their drawing as easy to understand as possible. And so that's why they use those lines oriented towards directions of curvature. So thanks to those two sources of information, we can now be quite confident that the cross sections are aligned with directions of curvature. And now we can start to do math, geometry, and optimization, because we know a lot about directions of curvature. Very simply, we know that they are orthogonal on the surface. So that gives us a new constraint. Every time we will observe two intersecting cross sections in a drawing, even though their angle in 2D is not 90 degrees, we know that in 3D they should be orthogonal. So we can formulate that as a constraint to be satisfied by the 3D reconstruction. So with the same methodology, we derived other properties of those cross sections. We observed that they are often created by intersecting the shape with orthogonal section planes. They are often delineate global or local symmetry. And also designers often draw their shapes from what they call an informative viewpoint. So a three-quarter viewpoint that shows most of the shape. So you see all sides of this little truck, which is more informative than, let's say, a side viewpoint that will only show that part of the shape. So we, again, try to express all those properties as mathematical properties of the curves we are trying to reconstruct. And basically, we could express all of them as a function either of the normals of the section planes or tangents of the actual curves. And so we can then formulate an optimization which, for each intersecting curves, we get a set of constraints. And by combining all of them in a global system, we can solve for the normal of the section plane, the offset with respect to the origin, and the depth of the tangent vectors of each curve. And so that's we solve it in a least square sense. And so just to illustrate how it works, given this line drawing of a computer mouse, here we ask the user to indicate what lines, what curves are cross sections here in orange. Based on our optimization, we can recover the 3D section planes. From that, we can deduce the surface normal at each intersection. Then we propagate those normals along the curves, and we can then also propagate them in between the curves to finally obtain what we call a normal field. So we don't have yet the 3D surface, but we at least have the local orientation. So here we use a color coding where basically different colors represent different orientations. And so from a computer graphics perspective, that's already quite rich because we can use that to compute shading. So we can give a 3D rendering to the line drawing even though we don't have yet the complete 3D shape. So this is a little video showing how users could use this system. So as soon as two cross-section lines intersect, the system can provide a first estimate of the surface normal. And once the drawing is complete, we call the solver. It takes a few seconds to generate the normal field, which can then be visualized interactively to get a more of a 3D impression of this line drawing. And then we have a system of layers, like in Photoshop, to add details. And so here are a few more results. The goal here we were targeting is to help designers visualize different appearances from the same line drawing. So instead of having to redraw and repaint every time they want to show their client a slightly different concept, they can use a single line drawing and then show how this object will look like with different material and under different lighting. So that was in 2012. 2 years later, we had a follow-up where we actually managed to go all the way to a 3D model. So we added a few more regularity constraints. So we tried to make lines that are nearly parallel. We tried to force them to be perfectly parallel. If lines were nearly perpendicular, we tried to make them perfectly perpendicular. Same for planarity. So basically, we used the solution we had in 2012 to get an initial guess of the 3D model, and then we solved for additional constraints to regularize the output and make it, well, basically this was the key to correct for perspective inaccuracies, because those line drawings are still quite approximate. And we note also that we use symmetry to complete the object and have also the hidden parts. This is another example. And here we show those drawings, we took them from books on design. So we tried to start with real drawings, yet we had to trace them, to trace vector curves over those line drawings, because ultimately to perform geometric optimization, we need some geometric object to work with. Just a bitmap made of pixels was not enough. So this is a real input to our system. And that's I think that's actually the limitation of this family of work, that to perform all those optimization, we do need a quite clean curve network, while designers don't draw that way. They often just take a pen and paper and sketch freely, and that's why they like drawing, that they don't have any constraints. So we cannot process those drawings directly. And so far, there's no automatic way to convert such a drawing into the one on the right. It's a problem called vectorization, how to convert a bitmap drawing into a set of Bezier curves, let's say. But it's a difficult problem. We worked a bit on it. This is just a snapshot of a recent paper, where given a rough drawing like this one, if we apply existing tools, because the drawing is made of many little lines, existing tools will tend to produce many little curves, which is not really appropriate for the type of optimization we want to do later on. One option could be to filter the drawing before applying the vectorization, but then you see that the junctions are a bit approximate as well. We have too many little curves. So on the right, we have our results where we added an additional objective to the vectorization, which is an objective of simplicity, sparsity. We wanted as few curves as possible to explain the line drawing. And that was a key to obtain clean junctions, do I have my mouse? Yeah, here, where basically an X junction is easier to explain as two crossing curves than four curves joining at a point. And so by forcing the algorithm to find a simple explanation, we could get slightly better results than prior work. But still, it's ongoing work in the sense that we are not yet able to directly vectorize a drawing and process it to reconstruct it in 3D. There's still some kind of gap here between what we can extract automatically and what we can process later on. And actually, that's what motivated our follow-up work on data-driven methods, because with the progress of machine learning and in particular deep learning, there are now methods that are much more robust to ambiguity and noise in the data. And so we wanted to explore that line of work or that family of methods as well. So you'll see that it's completely separate from what I've presented so far. Starting now, I will adopt a purely data-driven approach with no geometric optimization. But keep in mind that the two could be combined together. So the method I will describe next is actually a collaboration from somebody you may know, Mathieu Aubry, from École des Ponts. I think he's in the Imagine group. And we also collaborated with people from Berkeley at the time. Where here we try to solve our problem of 3D reconstruction using deep learning. So I will first start with a demo of our system. Here you see that the user can draw with a pen tablet as he will draw on paper. So you can really sketch with a little pen. You don't have to create clean vector graphics. You can sketch and erase. And then when the drawing is complete, you can ask the system to recreate the shape in 3D. And if it's not satisfactory, the user can continue sketching from a different viewpoint to correct any mistake. And the system will try to find the 3D reconstruction that best satisfies the drawings. I have the impression that the slides progress on their own, so I will just... Right, so I just play the video again to finish what I wanted to say. So really what I like with this system is that I like the workflow it allows, because the user can just sketch freely, and when he's satisfied, he can rotate around the 3D object immediately and continue sketching from a different viewpoint. So there's really this iterative workflow between drawing and 3D modeling. But you see that the 3D surface is a bit approximate. It's very smooth, and that's due to the current limitation of deep learning and about the representation we chose for the 3D object. So I will now give a brief description of how it works. So we first have, so it's based on deep neural networks. So we have a first network that takes as input a line drawing, and that predicts a volumetric representation of the shape. So it's a voxel grid, so a grid of points in space. And the task of the network is to predict if a voxel should be occupied or not by the shape. And so we train this network with many pairs of line drawing and 3D shapes. I will explain that later on. Then once the drawing has been interpreted, the user can rotate the shape. And here, for instance, we see that from a different viewpoint, the wheels are missing on the other side. So the user can draw them in a new line drawing, but still use the existing prediction as a guidance, so that the user knows where to draw. And then we have a second network that takes now two inputs, the new drawing as well as the existing prediction, and will update the prediction to produce a new shape. And that's how iteratively we can add as many drawings as we want, because the updater will always take the latest prediction and improve it with the new drawing. So now the question is how to obtain the training data. As I said, for such a system, you need many pairs of line drawing and the corresponding 3D models in the order of thousands of drawings and 3D models. So one option would be to pay people to draw, but that's not really feasible, I think, because as you see, a drawing takes minutes or even hours to create. In our case, we even need the drawing to represent a known 3D shape that we can align with the drawing to build the training data. So basically, we felt that this was not an appropriate way to proceed, or at least it would be very difficult to do it this way. So being researchers in computer graphics, we chose instead to render drawings automatically from 3D shapes. So we generated thousands of abstract 3D shapes by assembling little cubes and cylinders and other primitives. So those shapes don't represent any existing object, not an object you could recognize, but it's a way to generate a lot of variety and still locally the type of geometric configuration we observe are quite typical of man-made objects. And then we have a simple algorithm to extract contours and render them as if they were line drawings. So it was a way to generate our data completely synthetically. And even though we only have synthetic data, the system is still able then to proceed real drawings. So here, all those results were created with the system, where I show here the drawings created by the user. And so you see that depending on the object, the user chose to draw two or three drawings. Some were drawn from a perspective viewpoint, others from a front or side viewpoint. So that's the type of freedom that the system offers. As I mentioned earlier, really the main limitation at this stage is that the volumetric prediction we chose, as I said, the network needs to predict a voxel grid. This is a data structure that quickly takes a lot of memory. So in that work, we were restricted to a grid of 64 cube pixels. So 64 times 64 times 64. So we have a low resolution in the output. And that's why the shapes are very smooth. They lack fine details, just because we don't have the resolution yet to predict fine details. And also because, despite its power, deep learning still struggles to predict fine details because there's a lot of ambiguity in those line drawings. But really, this is more of a limitation of the representation we chose, the fact that we worked with voxel grids. So I will present now a slightly different approach, still based on deep learning, but instead of using voxels, we use parametric shapes. So we restricted ourselves to shapes that can be expressed with a few parameters. So this is a work we did in collaboration with people from Purdue. So the idea now is that we'll ask the system to, given a drawing of a shape that the system is able to recognize, predict its parameters. So in the case of a cube, predict the width, depth, and height of the cube and the position of one of its corners. So really, those few numbers are enough to describe a cube. So this makes the problem much easier in a sense, because we only have to predict a few parameters compared to the 64 cube binary variables that we had to predict for the voxel prediction. So we here have to actually predict way less unknowns. So in terms of architecture, we have actually two deep networks. The first one is a recognition network, so its task is to recognize if the shape is a cube or a cylinder or any of the basic shapes we can handle. And once we've recognized which shape it is, we have a second network that predicts its parameters. So we have one such network for each basic shape. We have one network to predict parameters of cubes, another one for cylinders, another one for whatever basic primitives our system can support. And the strength of this approach is that really those deep networks are quite robust to noisy input. So here in a little demo, you see that the cube and the cylinders are very well reconstructed, even though the drawing was quite approximate. But this is because the system can only produce nice cubes and cylinders. Its parametric shapes, it's not able to produce distorted cubes because they were not in the set of shapes the system could reconstruct. So in a sense, the parametric approach provides robustness, but it also restricts the family of shapes that we can handle. And again, we train with synthetic data. Here we actually added a bit of noise in the drawings to make them look even more like hand-drawn drawings. So equipped with this system, we integrated it in a 3D modeler for buildings. So here it's simple buildings. I will say it's more like for video games or quick prototyping. But the system was trained to recognize basic elements of buildings like windows, roof, mass. And then by assembling those primitives, the user can create quickly some rather complex shapes. And because everything is parametric, once created, the user can resize the building. The size of the windows will automatically be updated because they are part of the parameters of the shape. And so here are a few more buildings created with this system. Just to show that even though we have a limited set of primitives in terms of windows, roofs, and so on, by assembling them, we can still cover a decent variability. Okay, so this concludes that part on using deep learning for this same problem of 3D reconstruction. But I wanted to remind you of the long-term goal we are trying to achieve, which is to not only reconstruct in 3D, but also go all the way to providing a feedback to the user about the feasibility of the concept. So going all the way to the actual fabrication of the prototype. So that's our goal, but we didn't do much on that yet. One of the recent projects we worked on is on the fabrication, design and fabrication of mechanical objects. So it's again with people from Purdue, and it was just presented a few weeks ago at Eurographics. So we focused on a family of objects that can be created with mechanical linkages. So here you see a few such objects. Sorry, the videos don't play very well. But it's those families of objects where the mechanism is achieved thanks to linkages. And the challenge from a design perspective is that the user not only wants to define the shape of the object, he also wants to define the motion of that object, the animation. And an extra challenge is that this motion is achieved by a mechanism. So the designer should also know about the properties of mechanism to achieve his goal. But in practice, it's quite difficult to design a linkage. This is a simple example. We'd like this shape to go through those three poses. But you'll see that by changing very little in the mechanism, you realize that the motion changes a lot. So if you had to create such a shape by hand, you'll have to go through many trial and error before finding the proper parameters of the linkage to achieve your goal. So instead of this trial and error, We wanted to propose a system more based on definition of the actual goal. So the user can draw the shape he wants, and then for the moving part, indicate a few key poses. So indicate where the shape should be at different times. And then the system will find the linkage that makes those shapes traverse the desired pose in the following the smoothest trajectory. So really it's, and then we can fabricate the prototype because the system also produces the linkage automatically. So we can print it and fabricate it. So it's more for little toys at this stage, but it showed the idea of going from a line drawing all the way to a physical prototype. And really I insist on the idea that here the interpretation of the drawing is also constrained by what linkages can create. So in a sense, the user only indicated three key poses, but we recovered the entire trajectory because we could not generate arbitrary trajectory. We can only generate trajectories that can be produced by a linkage. And so I really like this idea that the fabrication constraints here help us understand what the user is trying to do. So just a few details about how we achieved that, how we produce that system. So algorithmically, we actually follow kind of a brute force optimization approach. We use sampling. We tried many linkages and select the one that worked best. So the sampling method starts with the input. So we have the fixed body and the moving body in the three poses here. We can have as many poses as we want. We then sample the points, the linkage points on the fixed body. We sample also the linkage point on the moving body. So we sample that point and then we deduce the others just by applying the transformation of the moving body. And then we optimize those points to obtain a linkage, a link that has a constant length along the animation, because that's a physical constraint. We cannot create links that will change length once fabricated. Then we can repeat the same for a second link and find, once we have two links, we obtain a four-bar linkage that will generate the animation. But in practice, we actually need, so here was a solution that was valid, but in practice, we need to sample many such linkages because most of them are actually invalid. So in that case, this is a solution that produces a collision. And there's other type of defects that those linkages could have. So really, here is the basic algorithm, but in practice, we need to repeat that many times to find a valid linkage. Often there's several valid linkages, but they will yield slightly different trajectories. So once we have a set of valid ones, we will perform a local optimization to refine them and select the one that yield the smoothest trajectory, that create the smallest linkage system, and we have a few more objectives to measure the quality of a linkage and really select the best one. But because the sampling loop is very fast, even though we need to sample a lot, we still obtain a valid linkage after a few seconds. So it's still fast enough to be usable interactively. And so I will here illustrate a second design session. Here it's to design a garbage truck. And you'll see that, I mean, it takes from seconds to minutes to find a valid solution. And here the three poses were really necessary to indicate that the bin should rotate only at the end of the trajectory, so that the garbage will fall in the truck and not on the driver. And here is just a little animation of how we can then create the physical prototype. And so here are a few more results. See that some contain multiple, more than two moving parts. Here three. Here we have a slightly different type of linkage. It's called a slider, but it's all based on the same general approach. It's just to illustrate a variety of objects we could create with that. All right, so to conclude, really the goal of our group is to allow the interpretation of drawings by computers in the hope of bringing a greater synergy between design and engineering. And the methodologies we've tried to apply is to formalize the principles that designers follow when they draw, because that can help us either derive geometric constraints on the drawing and on the shape that the drawings represent, but can also inform us on how to generate training data that reproduce, that mimic real drawings, and that we can use to train machine learning algorithms in the idea that I think machine learning and geometric optimization can work together. I will end by mentioning briefly a recent project that we just submitted, so it's under review, but I think it could inform, give you an idea of where we're trying to go. So it's a slightly different type of project. It's not algorithmic at all. It's a data collection, a project on data collection. We wanted to collect real-world drawings to inform our work. So we worked with people from TU Delft, from the design department, and we hired professional designers to draw shapes for us. So in total, we obtained 400 design drawings. They represent 12 objects that we designed to cover the typical geometric configurations that designers often encounter. We asked them to draw them in two different styles. So first, they construct the drawing, and they use those a lot of construction lines to create the shape in 3D. They had to use those because we only showed them those side, top, and front view of the shape, and we asked them to draw the shape from a new viewpoint. And really, designers, when they have to perform this task, when they have an idea of the shape but they don't have a model in front of them, they use those techniques to construct the perspective accurately. But then we ask them to also trace a clean drawing on top of the original one. We registered the 3D model, and we also we annotated every stroke so that we know what type of line is drawn. So we can we annotated that this is a construction line, this is more of a silhouette, this is more of a ridge or a valley. So we have a stroke-by-stroke labeling of this data. So I hope that the projector has a good contrast, so you can see the variability of shapes and styles that we have. Because every shape was drawn by several different designers, and every designer drew several shapes. So we can really compare different styles and see how what are the techniques that are the most popular. And here it's a little visualization of how good those drawings are in terms of 3D accuracy, because in most of them, when we register a 3D model, there's a pretty good alignment, but it also tells us typically how much error we can expect from one such drawing, which is also interesting for us, because when we do a 3D reconstruction, we need to be aware of the tolerance we should admit in the reprojection. And finally, this is a visualization of the raw data. So for each drawing, we have the entire history of its creation, because we recorded the drawings with a tablet. And here the colors indicate the type of line that we labeled. So really, it was a lot of work to collect those drawings and annotate them, but we think that it will be a really helpful data set to inform future research on that in that domain. And to be honest, I just find those very nice. So I spend lots of time watching those videos, because for me, it's fascinating to see how designers manage to create those complex shapes just one stroke at a time. But really, what that suggests in the immediate next step is that the type of drawing we use for training our system is far from being realistic compared to what people really draw. And that tells us that not only there is a big challenge in reconstructing 3D model from line drawing, but there's an equally difficult challenge of generating line drawing from 3D models. And so far in the computer graphics literature, those two have been explored quite independently, but I think that they could actually be solved jointly. Ideally, we'd like a method that is able to start from a line drawing and generate a 3D model such that if we take that 3D model and render it as a line drawing, we should obtain a line drawing that is close to the input. Basically, we don't want to lose information through the process because the line drawing is supposed to convey as much 3D information as possible. Or said differently, if we start from a 3D model and render it as a line drawing, then we should be able to process this line drawing to recover a 3D shape that is close to the input. So you see that there are two cycles here. We should be able to go from line drawing to 3D model and back to line drawing without losing information, or from 3D model to line drawing back to 3D model without losing information. And I think that this approach, which has been used, this idea of a cycle, they call it cycle consistency, it's been used in machine translation to translate from different languages. Here, I think it could be used to translate from different visual representation. So that's just to share you an idea I'm thinking about, which is that solving those two problems jointly could actually do better than trying to treat them separately. All right, so that concludes my talk. As I said, it was aimed to be an overview of what we do, but if you're more interested by a particular project, I'm happy to answer specific questions.